Welcome to the second session of our Ahwa and Kalam lunch hour series for this semester. Please help yourselves. There is coffee and some sandwiches at the back. So please feel free to help yourselves. We are particularly honored to have with us today Professor Muhammad Siraj. I'm sure many of you are familiar with him and have studied courses with him. Professor Siraj is Professor of Islamic Studies at the Department of Arab and Islamic Civilizations. And today he will talk to us about quite an interesting topic that brings together both traditional Islamic studies and sciences as well as modern and contemporary concerns. So many of you might be familiar with the idea that the modern legal system in a country like Egypt, and indeed in many Arab countries, is that, exactly that, very modern, sometimes alien, sometimes referred to as simply a copy of Western legal codes. Dr. Siraj's talk today will question this assumption and will show us how the modern Egyptian legal system integrated Islamic law and will question some of these common held cliches. So without further ado, Professor Siraj.
Thank you very much, Amina, and for all of you for coming to share with me some of my ideas about the how Islamic law survived the I would call it the earthquake or the occupation, and what happened during the second half of the 19th century up to 1949. Let me start emphasizing some sort of framework for me. It's here that any law shapes and is shaped also by the society and reflects the culture and the set of norms accepted by a given society that determines what is good and what is bad. This is the certain school, very famous school, the sociological school of law, that looks to the law in this understanding. So many of our leading lawyers, like Abdulrazak Salmouni, in fact, was very much following this this school. I wanted to discuss, of course, the topic is very vast, and I will not be able to discuss all the details. Therefore, I will select certain principles or certain concepts to share with you for today. What is modernization? It's a very complicated process of changing certain legal system from certain position to what we are witnessing nowadays. Also, I would like for you to understand that there is a big difference between what we call it Sharia and what we call it Fiqh. Sharia, in fact, contains the main principles of the Quran and Sunnah as well, which establish in fact what we may call it the basic norms or the basic principles. While fiqh or jurisprudence in fact is different from that. We'll talk about it afterwards. So I will talk about this distinction between Sharia and fiqh, and I will also try to divide the area that I'm examining between the 13th century preceding the middle of 19th century and the second half of the 19th century up to 1494. This was the date of promulgating the Egyptian civil law, which was very important date and also very important codification in the whole of the Arab world. I will talk about what happened during this was the context where the modernization process started. And it was, of course, affected very much by what was going on in this this period. I will talk about the legal system from the second half up to and the modernization and also the consequences. Yeah, and what happened with that? So this is the modernization definition. And the distinction between Sharia, just certain examples to show the or to illustrate what we understand by the term Sharia. Yeah, and the first surah, yeah, and the first verse here, verse surah 4, and the verses number 135, is emphasizing very much justice, the concept of justice. This concept is very important for the development, for example, of the Anglo-Saxon laws. The other principle related to religious freedom, this is in Surah number 2 and the verses number 218. Tolerance between Muslims and others was expressed also in the Surah 60. Verses 8 and 9. Human dignity was emphasized very much in the surah number 17 and the verses number 17. So these are the major principles which were taken into consideration by the lawyers or by the fuqaha or the jurists and tried to detail their own scheme on the basis of these major principles. The Sharia represents, in fact, what we consider it to be the marji'iyya, or the essential authority for the detailed cases or principles or whatever. This is the representing the essential. This is not developed. These are just precepts in the Quran and the Sunnah, and you cannot add or take from any of these basic principles. But for the fiqh, this another thing, that is jurisprudence, which means deep understanding of human beings' actions to regulate their relationships in view of the Sharia principles. Fiqh, therefore, is the product of human beings for regulating the lives and relations of human beings on the basis of justice, equality, and freedom, and some other principles, according at least to certain schools. So fiqh can develop, can change from one time to another, according to, just to illustrate, according to As-Sanuri, for example, riba or interest can be considered as permissible in our own time, while it was not permitted according to the interpretation of the understanding of the traditional scholars. So, just to understand what was the how the fiqh or jurisprudence was developed. For example, first of all, the contribution of judges was very important in the development of Islamic law. Particularly in the first century and second century of Islam, before the development of legal schools. Yeah, the Prophet died and the empire expanded, and there had to be a very effective sort of court system which would regulate the relationships between individuals in this society. Otherwise, the whole state would collapse. The legal system is very important for the survival of the state. So the judges started their business in the first century of Islam, and they did marvelous job, in fact. After that, the jurists were trying to just to theorize what was done by these judges. So the judges were deciding cases, setting precedents throughout our history, in fact. There was also a distinction between the contribution of the judges and the contribution of the jurists. The judges were most of the time, or all the times, were very practical, facing social problems and deciding solutions to these problems. So they did not stop it at all. Their work was going on continuously over our history, yeah, over 13th century almost. Just to know the type of precedents set by the judges or the contribution of the judges, which is totally ignored in understanding the history of Islamic law, the contribution of judges is totally ignored. And we are deciding the history of Islamic law on the basis just of these texts which are used or were used or have been used only for teaching Islamic law for new generations. Therefore, these books are not, in fact, the only contribution done by the Muslim, in the legal, in the Islamic legal system. So the judges continued. Yeah, and I wanted just to explain the contribution of judges and how they were setting precedents or you see, execution in case of more than one person participated in the murder. If someone is murdered by three people, if this was the case, or by more than one person, then execution will be the punishment. That was decided in this case. And that was accepted by all the Muslim jurists throughout. Ibn Fardun, for example, in North Africa, decided that when a woman is divorced, then she has the right of having half of the whole wealth acquired by the husband during their marital life. So these sort of precedents were made by the judges in our history. So that was the contribution of judges. This I in fact propose that those who are interested in writing the history of Islamic law or the history of Islamic society, that they will have to take into consideration the contributions made by the judges. Very rich contribution as made by the judges. I am emphasizing again that the great Muslim empires implemented Islamic legal system throughout, as shown in the works of jurisprudence, codifications, and records of courts, etc. So that was, the development of Islamic law up to 16th century was very advanced and recognized by someone like Joseph Schach, who considered Islamic law in the 16th century to be superior if compared with any other European system at that time. So up to 16th century, almost, Islamic law was considered to be the only advanced legal system in the world. So it's very important to know that. The modernization process, I would like to tackle it on these lines. First of all, yeah, and that was very advanced legal system, the green area, over 13 centuries was very advanced, controlling the society, deciding cases. No single case was not decided by the judges when was presented or filed to the concerned judge. The problem started in the second half of 19th century up to 1949. We will have as a sort of very absolutely defective legal system, diversified, consisting of so many different systems that cannot come together and constitute one system. Hmm? You have different systems. Okay, that sparked or encouraged the Muslim scholars, whether lawyers and another distinctions to be made here, between mashaykh or jurists, the traditional scholars, and the lawyers. They came together and tried to modernize the Islamic legal system in view of the difficulties took place in the second half of the 19th century up to 1949. I would say that was also very brilliant type of work which is not discussed or revealed at all by so many of our scholars in the modern time. I will try to rediscover these efforts done by the lawyers and the mashayikh, basically by the lawyers. Yani I'm just saying the mashayikh or the traditional scholars just for, yani, I mean, I have to be favorable also to them. So the modernization efforts made to modernize the system of Islamic law includes, in fact, comparative studies. This is very important, particularly between French and Islamic law. This one. The second thing is codification. That's to arrange the law in a certain manner, and also discovering new writing modalities. The old modality cannot match what is required from the system. Therefore, these were the lines of development for, of course, there are so many other things. I may talk about, for example, legal education in the Khedevi Law School. That institution was very important, and it is not studied up to now the contribution of this school in particular in the political life, in the legal contributions or advancements. This school is very important. But anyway, I may just not have the time to deal with that. But it's very important. And I have a student of mine, I'm supervising his thesis on the activities of this school. So the consequences brought to us the existing system, composed also of certain elements from Islamic law, traditional Islamic law, and also the Western legal different systems. So let us go back to, yeah, we know now that Islamic law was very much advanced up to the, perhaps the 19th century, and it was working. The laws promulgated by Muhammad Ali, for example, was done under the concept of siyasa sharia, that allows, in fact, the ruler or the community to regulate or to codify laws on the basis of social interest. Siyasa sharia, in fact, is based on what we call it maslaha. So siyasa sharia was very important and allowed throughout our history to do codifications and regulations, and particularly during the Ottoman Empire, and Dr. Nelly here knows a lot about this, these regulations. Qanun Nama, so many regulations promulgated, in fact, throughout our history. So it was a very advanced system, catering for the needs of the society. This is very important. You see, the law is not poetry, is not literature. Yeah, I mean, the paradigm is always whether the system caters for the needs of the society or is not able to serve the interests of the society. The system was serving the interests of the society. okay, up to the middle of 19th century. All right, what happened afterwards that in the first half, that was the advanced period, we will find the courts sitting precedents. This is the image of a court at that time. Regulations from the time of the Umayyads, Abbasids, Ottomans, Mughals, all of that. And jurisprudence. With these wings, in fact, the system was able to fly and to serve the needs of the society. Okay, what happened afterwards was very dramatic change. Suleiman the Magnificent, or as we call it, Suleiman al-Qanuni, that shows also or demonstrates, I mean the title demonstrates that he was very, during his time there were very efficient regulations drafted by the great scholar who is not researched at all, just few articles or so, Abu Saud al-Imadi. Yani that was a great scholar and jurist who was codifying laws for so many areas in the Ottoman Empire. So that was during the second half, this is the period of crisis, I would call it. This is the period of the legal crisis. We were left, or the Egyptian country, underwent this crisis in this period, where you will find sort of very Sharia courts. So the system from here would start facing certain problem or certain crisis. The diversity of the system does not allow a sort of unified framework for the implementation of justice in the country. I hope I'm clear in that. Yeah, when the system does not have certain unified philosophy, don't expect from the system to work very efficiently or very well. When it is diversified, then there's a great problem. There will be no sort of philosophical framework to accommodate all of the different areas. Okay, so capitulations. You will be surprised to know that it was implemented by the consulate of 17 European states, which was replaced afterwards. Of course, when you have this sort of very dramatic situation, then you will accept whatever. So it was through an international treaty that Egypt had to accept this mixed courts, which unified all of these European consulates and different systems. So because the system is suffering this way from this sort of diversity. My grandfather, for example, was to sell or to have any difficulty with any Greek, for example, trader. I'm talking about grandfather. I don't know whether he was to go for Athens, for example, to make the case or to the, and he had to learn Greek language in order to be able to manage this dispute. That was very difficult for the Egyptians in general. Once they have any difficulty with a foreign individual, then it is a very bad situation. So the mixed courts, in fact, there was a codified law made in a sort of, in a hurry, and it was not very well done. That was inaugurated 1875, right? And the national laws, yeah, when the British came, just 1882, occupied the country, 1 year only after that, the whole system changed, leaving the Mahakim Sharia, or the Sharia courts, to the field of family laws only, while the national laws cover the criminal, civil, procedural, whatever, yani, the other areas of law. So the sort of distorted system had to be, you see, working against, or to bring some sort of reforms to this sort of very ineffective system. That was the, so Islamic law, legal system was implemented by the traditional Sharia courts, foreign capitulations administered by the consulate, etc. And also the national laws of 1883. Yeah, the system is comprised now of three different, absolutely different systems. With that, we have to do a lot of things. The reformers, in fact, did or struggled, in fact, against this defective system. Whether they succeeded, yeah, this is the situation that we are. Accumulation of all of these efforts. So what, yeah, I would like just to describe these efforts, because most of them are not known to the historians of Islamic law. First of all, comparative studies, and then codifications, and the search for new writing modalities, and Islamic legal education. I would like very much to focus on the activities made by this man, Qadri Basha, the Minister of Justice, up to, yeah, he was appointed Minister of Justice two times. He participated in the codification of the laws for the mixed courts and for also the national laws. He was graduated from the School of Languages, Madrasat al-Alsun. So that was a very important person, and he did a lot of things. Perhaps I will talk about it after that. The comparative approach was initiated, in fact, by the Muslim scholars at that time, and it was a very magnificent story. First of all, Khedive Ismail asked Rifa' Qattawi, the Egyptian reformer, to translate the French law. Right, this is the first link. The second link, he ordered his, or requested his judge, Makhlouf al-Minyawi, to conduct a research between the similarities and the differences between the French system. That was, yeah, he produced a book called Muqaranat Shar'iyya, yani Muqaranat, yani the comparison between. This was, yeah, of course, a very important book. I edited or co-edited this book, in fact, yeah, almost 20 years ago, just to show also that, yeah, the contribution of the Muslim scholars in that period. Of course, the comparison was, or is considered to be, the most important approach in taking Islamic law from the traditional position to the modern time. And with that sort of comparison, the traditional concepts were seen in view of the other, or the principles of other modern legal principles. And I think that the achievement of conducting this comparative approach was very important in shaping even the situation, the legal position of Egypt and of most of the Arab societies. This again was done by a lawyer who studied in Al-Azhar and then moved to Sorbonne and conducted also another research but more comprehensive than that of Makhlouf al-Minyawi. The other contribution was made by someone called Abdullah Hussein Ali. I again co-edited also this work because I think that was very important. The comparative studies also were contributed to Islamic law by the deans of Khedive schools. So, yeah, I mean, many famous jurists and lawyers from Britain, from France, and from some other places in Europe. I would like very much to mention certain names who were considered to be the pioneers of comparative studies in the whole world, yeah, not only in this area. So I would like to mention the name of Lambert, for example, Amos, Walton. So many of them conducted certain research comparing between the Islamic legal principles and the European norms and standards as well. So Lambert was a sort of very important person because he received, when he left the school, he went to Lyon in France, when he received, or where he received 50 students interested in conducting comparative researches. And therefore, we will find so many beautiful, in fact, or very important researches made, in fact, by these students who took Islamic law ahead. So Lambert was, the Egyptians will have to celebrate the activities of this man. Lambert graduated, for example, someone like Abdelrazzak al-Sanhouri. Abdelrazzak al-Sanhouri learned a lot from Lambert. And he, when Sanhouri, for the first time when he went to France, was doing his PhD, in fact, he, for the first time, he started talking about comparative approaches and also the need to conduct researches comparing between Islamic law and was talking also about the revival of Islamic law on the basis of the concept of the sociological school of law. Yeah, that the law will have to express or to mirror the society. So Abdelrazzak al-Sanhouri learned over there in Lyon that the comparative approach is very much needed for the advancement of the legal system. He was not, his issue was not Islamic law. His issue was the legal independence of the country. He wanted to have a system that provides for the administration of justice in the country, not only in Egypt, but also in Arab countries. So he was not just a student of Islamic law before he left. He was just, he studied earlier in the law school. And then when he went to Lyon and studied Islamic law under the supervision of Lambert, then he started talking about. So Sanhouri, I would like to say he was created in this period. Before that, he did not talk at all about Islamic law. Afterwards, I am, my evidence for that is his awraq shakhsiyya, Sanhouri awraq shakhsiyya. You will find him talking only about Islamic law after he left for Lyon and was conducting his research under the supervision of Lambert in particular. But there were, of course, so many of, you see, one thesis which was very important, I would like, and Abdelrazak Al-Sanhouri, in fact, was planning to have it translated into Arabic, that of Ahmed Fathi on the abuse of right. This concept of abuse of right is very important, extremely important in the French legal system. So Ahmed Fathi conducted a research comparing between Islamic law and the French system in respect of this very complicated concept of abuse of right. So that was the comparative approach which I believe it enriched Islamic law very much, and also it enriched our own systems, legal systems in the Arab and the Arab world. So it was very important. I would like to talk also about. So this is Abdelrazak Al-Sanhouri, who framed his calls for modernizing studies of Islamic law during his PhD studies in Lyon under the supervision of Lambert. He developed his comparative approach as the only possible methodology for the development of the Arab legal system. He was very much interested in unifying the Arab legal system throughout the comparative approach between Islamic law and as he thinks, he was a firm believer that the law will have to express the traditions of a given society. Yani, there's no way that you transplant. Am I exceeding my? Okay.
Yeah. 5 minutes, so we have questions and answers.
Okay. So this is the comparative approach. I will have to go through, to ignore some of these. But the second group was comprised of European beings of the Khalid school. Yeah, and this was very important. You will find so many studies made by these deans: the criminal Islamic law, the civil law, the laws of obligations, international laws also. Yeah, and so these deans, in fact, brought Islamic law to be noticed by the European scholars in this age. So that was important. Qualification also was very, very important. Yani, arranging the Islamic law in a form that is understandable to the contemporary students of law. Instead of just confining it to those who are trained in Islamic law in the traditional institutions like Al-Azhar and so on, yani they were arranging it in a manner that is understandable to the modern lawyer, and at the same time to be easy for the judges to refer to. So this is the codification. I wanted to say that there are two major efforts done in this respect. One official and the other is non-official. The official is represented, for example, by the very, very advanced piece of legal work, Majalat al-Ahkam al-Adliya. I'm really fond of this text. It's very important, though it is not ideal, but anyway, it helped a lot the continuity of Islamic law. Okay, so that was the official work. The other one is Murshid al-Hayran of Qadri Basha. Yani he did, Qadri Basha, the Egyptian Minister of Justice, did this codification, Murshid al-Hayran, in civil law, and did also he codified also the personal laws of marriage, divorce, inheritance and so on. So he did all of that. These works, in fact, helped Islamic law to be present in the Arab civil laws of our modern age. I don't know, yani, that needs a lot of explanation, but yani, I don't have time to do that. Yani, I mean, yani, the codifications of the Mujalla were called the whole of this area, the Sham, the Levant, Syria, Jordan, Palestine, Iraq, and yani, they were very much influenced by the Mujalla up to now. Their civil laws, in fact, are I mean, influenced or shaped, in fact, by the Mujalla. This civil law of the United Arab Emirates as well was very much shaped by the Mujalla and the Mursh al-Hayran as well. So Mursh al-Hayran was done unofficially by Qadri Basha, and the other one, Mujalla fi al-Ahkam al-Adliya, was done by the Ottoman Empire. So this is regulations, all of that. Islamic law allowed this sort of regulations and tanzimat and codifications under the concept of siyasa shar'i. The legislators or the legislature will have to do under the concept of maslaha or the public interest. So the law, if not reflective of the maslaha, is not a law according to Islamic law. If it reflects the maslaha, then it has to be considered as law. So I the methodology of writing fiqh or jurisprudence is absolutely different. Yani, if you see even up to now, yani, the difference between the writing of jurisprudence by the Khedevi school students of Islamic law or teachers of Islamic law, you will find it, and their product is different from the works written by Al-Azhar graduates. The difference, I mean, because they were there in the Khedevi school, they had to develop their own modes of writing. And therefore, you will have, for example, Sheikh Ahmad Ibrahim Bey, Muhammad Zayd Bey Al-Ibyani, Muhammad Salama Bey, all of them were recognized by the society. And therefore, they were granted this title because of their contribution in this period. As a matter of fact, these people, when codified the family law in Egypt, they were making a sort of progress in this field, not only for Egypt, but for all the Muslim world. Yeah, the same solutions suggested by these people, in fact, were utilized everywhere in the Muslim world, in the Arab world, first of all, and in the Muslim world. For example, child marriages, so many, the right of woman to conclude her own marriage contract. These people will have to be recognized. Up to now, they are totally ignored. Ahmad Ibrahim was the supervisor, for example, of Shafi Shahata, the great Egyptian jurist, in fact, who was, a Copt, but Sheikh Ibrahim was really supervising. And Shafi Shahata was not only a student, but in fact, a great supporter of Islamic law. So many other things, including Ahmad Ibrahim, the others, legal education, based on comparison and codification and the consequences, of course, that we have now this sort of mixed legal system between the traditional principles of Islamic law mixed with the European legal system. So it's not Islamic what we are having now, our system is not Islamic and also is not European. It's a mix of the two things nowadays. So Islamic law is still surviving because of the efforts of these reformers, I would say. They were great lawyers, basically, and most of the contributions were made not by the traditional students of Islamic law, but by lawyers. Hamar Abdi Gawad, Sanhouri, Ahmed Fathi, so many of the, in our schools of law now, it's very rare that you will find someone focusing only on one system. He is just most of the time to conduct this comparative research, whether in civil, whether in whatever. So,
Shafi Shahati, I like him very much, and I was fond of his writing.
Okay, whatever contributions made by, for example, the Arab League, they unified the Islamic law, codified the Islamic law, and you will not, in the memorandum of these laws, you will find the version of the legal versions is usually relied on the concepts of Islamic law. So I wanted to say that these activities were very successful in bringing about, I'm not talking about a religious system. I'm talking about a legal system serving the community or the interests of the community and the administration of justice in the community. I'm not talking about the rituals of Islam, fasting, prayer, and so on. This was included in fact, these works are educational texts. This is also my finding, that these works are educational textbooks used by the teachers who were teaching Islamic law for the new generations of muftis, of lawyers, of students of law in general. So these educational books, in fact, included the rituals of Islam because of the need for the new generations to know about these topics. But this note was not.
I think we have to ask this question: what will be the future?
I don't think that we are now in a better position than the earlier scholars, jurists, and lawyers. So things are now cloudy very much. I cannot tell you what will happen, whether we will have the laws of Daesh, for example, or Nusra, or whatever, instead of Abdulrazzaq al-Sarburi. I hope that the future is bright and is better than it was before, but we have to work on the basis and on the basis of the achievement of these great scholars.
5 minutes only, so I'm saved of the difficult questions. Okay.
Thank you very much, Professor. I think we won't really have time for questions and answers, but I think perhaps if Dr. Sarab has a few minutes, we can informally ask you. But thank you very much for coming, and we hope to see you at our next event.
Thank you.
If you have any questions, please go ahead and ask Dr. Sarab. We have a few minutes, you can ask it informally.
I have time for your questions.
I have one.
But so do, please.
The thing that you mentioned in the beginning of the of your presentation, that judges provided immediately after the death of the Prophet provided an important basis for the future of Islamic law. So do you think that it's important for us to also look at the origins or the earlier system when we ask this question about what the future of the Egyptian legal system is, or do you think that after this integration between these two, or this study of the attempted integration between the French system and the Islamic system. Do you think that that's just a point that we can't really go back?
I think it is very, it's very important to study the origin of our system nowadays, including the achievements done in the near future, in the near past, and also the philosophy that enabled us to work from the 19th century to the. It was a very tough experience. I don't know, if Ahmad Ibrahim, for example, a student of Islamic law, and was appointed in the Khudevi Law School, where the dean is Amos and Lambert and so many French personalities, and the students are studying French law in particular. So the problem before him was how to teach these students whose background is French legal system. So he endeavored. Therefore, we have to learn from this experience, and to know the judges also are very important. I mean, even the decisions made by the modern judges are very important, because the judge is influenced also by the culture of the community. He is not only implementing the text of the law, but he is also implementing the concept of concepts in his mind, the social concepts in his mind, the social norms determining what is good and what is bad. So the judge also, certain decisions made by the judges, particularly in the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court having nowadays the responsibility to apply Islamic law. So if any lawyer can go to the Supreme Court and file a case against a certain provision of the existing law, claiming unconstitutionality. So the judges of the Supreme Court are doing also, I would say, very important job. So we have, we don't have to ignore any of the past traditions and the activities made in the last 150 years, and also envisaging what should be our future. Now, I think the most problematic area in our countries, in the Arab countries, is their legal system. And they have to reform it. Otherwise, I don't know what will happen for these countries. So we are totally failing to have a sort of a legal system. In order to streamline it, we have to use or to be aware of all of our other experiments made in the past and the whole past. The judges in the first century were absolutely successful. There was not, at that time, jurisprudence. There were not schools of law. But the judge was thrown into the sea and was asked to swim. Decide, without having any sort of guidelines even. But he was having this sort of principles that I told you about: justice, tolerance, kindness to the weak members in the society. These sort of absolutely general principles. So the judge would have to rely on himself, his interpretation of these basic principles. And therefore they achieved a very important work in this period. So we have to, the students of history, of law, of even sociology will have to work hard in order to prepare the land for a sort of future jump. We need a jump. Now, in order to have a good, effective legal system, we have to have some sort of jumping from the situation that we are witnessing nowadays. Legal education is extremely bad. You see, I was a professor of Islamic law at the law school with almost 30,000 students in Alexandria University. So legal education is suffering, or is a part of the problem or of the dilemma that we are. We do not have some sort of philosophy also for our legal system. We do not have a sort of framework for our own legal system. So everyone can do, can promulgate law, anyone, and it will not be difficult for any authority to issue law, because we don't have the sort of unified philosophical framework. And this is my understanding, and that this area is very problematic. The legal area is very problematic. And everyone can say whatever he likes, because we don't have this sort of unifying philosophy. With that, I should thank you very much for your coming, and I hope we'll meet again and to discuss some other areas in this area. Thank you.